Good morning, everyone. Could extend a very warm welcome to all and any visitors who may be with us this morning, and anyone listening online. We do hope to enjoy our service this morning. As you can see, the service this morning contains the sacrament of Holy Communion. Again, if anyone wishes to not member of the church, they can take part if they wish. A couple of intimations. As I mentioned last week, our new interim moderator is the Reverend Derek Pope. Derek is the minister at North Munnell, Great New Bellhaven Parish Church. He wishes to come along and introduce himself, so he's coming on the 14th of April to take our service. But before that, he's coming on this coming week and Tuesday, the 19th of March, to take a board and session meeting. So a special board and session meeting on the 19th of March, that's a week and Tuesday at 7:30. And again, Derek will introduce himself to the office bearers, etc. The envelopes are available here for the elders and board members to distribute. That's for next year. They're right here on the table. And a couple of birthdays to mention today. We've got, Bella had a birthday on Tuesday. And today is a birthday for Carl Muir, Carl in the choir here. So Carl's birthday today. So Carl, we wish you very much a very happy birthday today. Decided on a charity. We've got a board session and board meeting in a fortnight's time, so we'll decide then. So it's for, it will be for a charity, so the retiring offering at the front if you wish to contribute to that.
That suggests the RNLI,
so
they're celebrating 200 years.
Oh, there's that. RNLI, excellent. Thanks, Margaret. Again, we welcome Margaret Rose to our pulpit this morning. Unfortunately, Margaret has quite a serious cough. So if you bear with her, she may have to kind of pause in between bits and pieces, but she's got a right dose out, you want to hear it? Frighten the life of me when I heard that in there. So Margaret, all being well, we look forward to you leading us this morning. Thank you.
Worship God, we sing Him, come let us to the Lord our God. on this day, and all things you give reason for us to rejoice and be glad. For you have loved the world in Jesus your Son, once and for all, for all days and all places, for all time. We bring our offering of praise in token return for your gift. Through parables, Jesus taught us the forgiveness is ours. To receive it, we only have to ask. Through the cross, Christ showed us that the promise is reality. Like the prodigal son, there are times when our choices have been poor, and we have wronged not only our neighbour, but you, our Father. We ask your grace and forgiveness. Look upon us, Lord. May the darkness of our souls vanish before the beams of your brightness. Fill us with holy love. Open to us treasures of your wisdom. Encourage what you have begun in us. And prompt us to ask in prayer what your Spirit already desires for us. Loving God, give us knowledge of your will. Strength of spirit to follow Christ's example. And courage to face the complexities of life. Grant that at all times we may stand firm for the faith and truly serve your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Would you like to have a story this morning? It means you don't have to do anything. I won't be asking any questions. Would you all like a story? Please say yes, because I've got a story. Once upon a time, in a land far away, there lived a king who had three daughters. The princesses loved their father very much. And so one day they decided that they would show the king just how much they loved him, by each giving him a special gift. The princesses worked hard and arranged a grand party for the king. Everyone was having a fabulous time. There were lots of nice things to eat and drink. Ice cream, jelly, wee tiny sausages that are really good, burgers, Coca-Cola, lemonade, and lots more. After a while, no one could eat anymore. So the princesses decided now would be a good time to hand the king their gifts. The eldest sister went first. She gave her father a casket of gold, saying, "I love you more than all the gold in the world. This casket of gold I give to you to remind you how much I love you." The king was very happy and patted her on the head. The second princess gave her father a pouch full of precious jewels. Saying, "I love you more than all the precious jewels in the world. This pouch of jewels I give to you to remind you how much I love you." The king was even happier and patted her on the head. Finally, the youngest princess gave her father a carton of salt, saying, "I love you more than all the salt in the world. This carton of salt I give to you to remind you how much I love you." The king was furious and thrust the salt back into her hand, shouting, "What good is salt? Is this a cruel joke? Do you love me so little that you give me salt?" princesses were very upset, and they all started to cry. Then the youngest sister had an idea and said to the royal cook, "Cook," she said, "for the next few days, do not use salt in any of the meals you prepare. Follow my instructions until the king sends for you." Well, the cook thought this to be a very strange request indeed. No salt in his cooking? Who had heard the like? However, he knew he had to obey the princess's orders. That night, the king sat down to dinner as normal. The servants brought in the soup, which the cook had prepared. The odium. The king took one mouthful and spat it out all over the place and ordered the servants to remove it. Next, he brought in a large dish of mashed potatoes, a platter of roast beef, and a dish of sweet corn. I wish I had breakfast. But oh no, the king spat all that out too. By this time, the king was jumping up and down in a rage and sent for the royal cook. The cook entered the great dining room. When the king saw him, he yelled at him, "What's the meaning of this? This food tastes awful. Are you trying to poison me?" The cook was afraid. But the king's youngest daughter came forward. "Father, don't blame the cook. Because you said that you saw no use for salt and that salt is of no value, I ordered the cook not to use any salt in any of the dishes he would prepare for you." The king thought about what his daughter had done. A smile crept onto his face and he said, "My dear child, you must love me very much indeed. You have shown me that salt is indeed precious, because a little salt changes the taste of my food enormously." And so he patted the little princess on the head, and they all lived happily ever after. Even in this time when we're trying to say, "Don't have as much salt, don't over salt," we actually need salt. Our bodies need salt. Not too much, but we need salt. And we've been given a very precious gift as well. Jesus is God's gift to us. And life tastes better when we accept him into our lives. We're going to sing one of my favorite hymns, "Jesus Loves Me." first scripture reading this morning comes from the New International Version. It's Joshua chapter 8, reading from verses 9 to 12. Then the Lord says to Joshua, "Today I have rolled away the reproach of Egypt from you." So the place has been called Gilgal to this day. On the evening of the 14th day of the month, while camped in Gilgal on the plains of Jericho, the Israelites celebrated the Passover. The day after the Passover, that very day, they ate some of the produce of the land, unleavened bread and roasted grain. The manna stopped the day after they ate this food from the land. There was no longer any manna to the Israelites, but that year they ate the produce of Canaan. Second reading comes from Corinthians. Corinthians 5, reading from verses 16 to 21. So far from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. Though we once regarded Christ in this way, we do so no longer. Therefore, anyone in Christ, the new creation, has come. The old is gone. The new is here. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us ministry of reconciliation. That was God reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting people's sins against them. And he committed us to the message of reconciliation, so we were therefore Christ's ambassadors. As though God was making his appeal through us, we implored you on Christ's behalf to reconcile to God. God made him who had no sin to be sin to us, so that in him we might become righteous of God. The third reading comes from Luke 16, verses 1 to 3, and Luke 15, 11 to 32. Now as the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering round to hear Jesus, but the Pharisees and the teachers of law muttered, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." Then Jesus told them this parable. There was once a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, "Father, give me share of thy estate." So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself to a citizen of the country, who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired servants have food to spare? And here I am, starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, 'I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants.' So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him and kissed him. The son says to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead, and he is alive again. He was lost and is found. So they began to celebrate. Meanwhile, the eldest son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard the music and dancing. So he called out to one of the servants and asked him what was going on. Your brother has come, he replied, and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has him back safe and sound. The elder brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him. But he answered his father, look, after all these years, I've been saving for you and never disobeyed your orders. Yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when a son of yours who squandered your property with prostitutes comes home, you kill the fattened calf for him. My son, the father said, you are always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad, because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is now found. Amen, and may God add his blessing to the reading of his holy word.
Sing Just As I Am.
Thank you.
remember how much we are loved. This is God's love for us, which is the deepest, most unshakable and unconditional love we will ever experience. It's a love that reaches out to us wherever we are, and no matter how deeply we have pushed it aside in the past. It is a love that cannot be measured, because there's no limit to it, and no degrees within it. God's love is not some kind of reward for good deeds. It's not measured out to us in proportion to how hard we have worked. Nothing you could do would make God love you any less. There are certainly things you can do that will limit or heighten your ability to experience that love. You can turn your back on love, or you can open yourself up to it. You can enjoy it for a while and then begin to take it for granted and fail to appreciate it. Nothing you or I can do is going to change the fact that God loves us completely. But the things we do and the choices we make will determine whether or not we live in God's love. Themes of sin, confession and reconciliation with God are a prominent focus of the Lenten season. They're certainly prominent in the two readings we heard earlier. The parable of the prodigal son may be read from several different perspectives. Jesus tells a story in response to the Pharisees and teachers of the law, diligent religious people, people who did their utmost to live in ways that were pleasing to God. They're feeling put out because Jesus is behaving as though God's favourites were actually the people who did everything that was irreligious and offensive to God. And it's in the face of that reaction that Jesus tells three similar parables about God's desire to find the lost. And then he puts a twist in the tale of the third one. The three parables all make the same point that Paul picks up and develops in his letter to the Corinthians. If you are missing out on the love of God, it is God's wish to reconcile you to him. God offers the olive branch to reach out and make reconciliation possible. God will search frantically till the lost sheep is found. Or if you've chosen to be lost and don't want to be found, God will wait anxiously, gazing longingly down the road, hoping that you will have a change of heart and respond to his love for you. And if you do, God will be waiting with open arms, welcoming you home. It sounds fantastic. But then Jesus puts a sting in the tail of the story. Jesus is well aware that it's easy to appreciate the benefits of your father's love when he's throwing a big party in your honour. It's not so easy when he just wants your company at harvest time. A hard day's work and a home-cooked meal looks great when you're starving in a strange land. But it doesn't look quite so appealing when you have it every day and have never experienced any hunger pangs. And so Jesus brings in the character of the elder brother, a character that most of us can probably relate to. This is a person who doesn't have a spectacular conversion story. He just grew up in the loving care of his father. There was never really a time when he felt alienated from that love. It had just always been there. And he had always been faithful. He worked hard and could always be relied upon to put in 100%. There are plenty of people for whom a Christian the discipleship has been like that. They grew up in the church. They never really put a foot wrong. Like always, they've had their moments, but they've never turned away from God to live the fast and selfish life. They've always been there, responsible and dependable. And the danger for them is the same as the danger for the older brother here. The older brother has become so used to a good life that he no longer sees how good he has it. In fact, he doesn't even see what he can do with it. He complains to his father, "All these years I've worked for you, and you never even gave me a young goat to have a party with my friends." And the father says, "I never gave you a goat. They're your goats. Everything I have is yours. If you want a goat, have as many as you want. They're your goats." How easily do we do that? We get hung up on doing our duty and being faithful and putting the work in. Then we forget to celebrate. We have a right to celebrate. God wants us to be celebratory people. Most of the images that Jesus used to describe the reign of God were images of celebrations and parties. And what's happened in the relationship between the two brothers? There's a part of the older brother that reckons that the prodigal has had it good. There's a part of him that says, "Why have I always been so good? Why didn't I get out there and have a good time like everybody else? Why was I the son of God?" The reality is that it's easy to think like that when you haven't tried it. The grass looks greener from the other side. But the prodigal found out that the grass looked greener because it was full of weeds and slimy moss. The prodigal had been to the other side, and when the other side had chewed him up and spat him out, as it usually does, he knew that the only good thing he could do to himself was to swallow his pride and go home. He'd learned the hard way why home was a good place to be. There are plenty of people who are still finding that out the hard way. But who, like the prodigal, probably won't admit it until they hit rock bottom. People who have abandoned the road that would in time have led to genuine love, healthy growth, and mature joy, and instead have attempted a shortcut, a fast life of cheap success and conspicuous consumption. I haven't met any whose happiness is more than skin deep. Beneath the manic maintenance of appearances, there is a nightmare of anxieties and regrets. Where have all the people who care about me gone? What if the share price falls? What if they find out what I'm really like? Did I embarrass myself last night? What if you find someone with more money and charisma? Why am I hung over and alone every morning? Prodigal had blown his whole inheritance. What he'd lost, he could never recover. And what he'd gained was horrific. He knew his older brother was on a good thing. It was only the older brother who couldn't see it. If you've never been a prodigal, you haven't missed much. Those who have can tell you that it can take a lot of years to repair the damage, even after you get home. If you've always been the one faithfully working at home, then the message of this parable is appreciate the love and security you have. Make the most of what you have now. There is no joy in life that God wants to deny you. Jesus was frequently accused by the religious leaders of being a glutton and a drunkard, because he was so often at parties and so often laughing and celebrating with friends who were joining with him in the serious business of transforming life on earth into the image of the great party that is the kingdom of God. Until we discover that together and joined with Jesus, we're going to stagger through life as either prodigals destroying ourselves and regressing it, or as resentful, pious folk who tried to do the right thing but forgot why and lost the plot. And as long as we are either of those, the waiting Father, our eager, loving God is waiting with arms open, longing to clasp us close and sing and dance and celebrate the joy of our inclusion in his eternal party. Amen. We sing in 187, there's a whiteness in God's mercy. Generous provider. Jesus said, I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. He was always a guest. In the homes of Peter and Jairus, Martha and Mary, Joanna and Susanna, he was always a guest. At the meal tables of the wealthy, where he pled the case of the poor, he was always the guest. Upsetting polite company, befriending isolated people, welcoming the stranger, he was always a guest. But here, at this table, he is the host. This, the table of our Lord, is laid for you. He invites you to join him now. So come not because you are strong, but because you are weak. Come not because any goodness of your own gives you a right, but because we seek mercy. Come because you love the Lord a little and would like to love him more. Come because he loves you and gave himself for you. Come and be nourished so that as we are fed and made new through our Lord Jesus Christ, we can go out and feed others in his name. What we do here, we do in imitation of what Christ first did. So let us be reminded by Paul how it all began. The tradition which I handed on to you came from the Lord himself. That on the night of his arrest, the Lord Jesus took bread, and after giving thanks to God, broke it, and said, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in memory of me. In the same way, he took the cup after supper and said, this cup is the new covenant sealed by my blood. Whenever you drink it, do this in memory of me. So now, following Jesus' example and command, we take this bread and this wine, the ordinary things of the world in which Christ has promised us his presence and through which he can make us whole. Let us pray. Loving God, we thank you that you have called us together as your people, your church, your family united in Christ. You accept us and love us unconditionally. Your love, which knows no bounds. Willingly, Jesus ate with those rejected and shunned by society. He makes with all who would receive him. His openness to others crossing all barriers. He has called us his friends. As we meet together in his name, so he is here among us. As we share this meal around his table, he is by our side. And as we share it with him, we share it with you, tasting life in all its fullness. Loving God, we thank you for this banquet instituted by Christ himself. Not only a memorial to his death, but also a celebration of his continual life. A reminder to his disciples then, and to his followers of all time, of your love for us all. For all this, O God, with all your people, and with the whole company of heaven, we praise you in the angel's hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. As we come to share the richness of this table, Lord God, we cannot forget those who hunger. Your world is one world, and we are stewards of its nourishment. Lord, put our prosperity in the service of the poor. We cannot forget those who thirst, those who are weary, and all peoples who cry out for justice. Lord, put our proneness at the service of those who are empty. We cannot hear your words of peace and forget those who are caught in the midst of war. Lord, show us how to turn weapons into tools and the lust for power into a desire for peace. We cannot hear of your healing touch and forget those who are ill at home or in hospital. We pray for those named in our group of prayer. Family, friends and colleagues of the late Kenny Duncan, Sylvia Devine, Mary Baird, Alec Tweedy, Linda Cooper, David Fisher, the Walker family, baby Myra Doherty, Sophia Thomas, family and friends of the late Robert Kennedy, family and friends of the late Bill McCart. Lord, through Christ, may we be instruments of comfort and aid. Merciful God, send now in kindness your Holy Spirit to settle on this bread and wine and fill them with the fullness of Jesus. And let that same Spirit rest on us, so that as we celebrate as your family, divisions are forgotten, and in the likeness of the one whose feast we now share, we may be instruments of healing and deliverers of good news. Hear now our prayers as we continue in the words Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. According to the holy institution, example and command of our Lord Jesus Christ, and as a memorial to him we do this, who on the night when he was betrayed took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way he took the cup, saying, this cup is a new covenant sealed by my blood. Whenever you drink it, do this in memory of me. Take, eat. This is the body of Christ which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of him. This cup is a new covenant sealed by the blood of Christ, which was shed for you. Drink from it, all of you. Son of God, have mercy upon us. Jesus, Saviour of the world, have mercy upon us. Jesus, King of heaven, grant us peace. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. So take this bread and this wine. God comes to us and them so that we may come to God. Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Let us pray. Gracious God, we give you glory, thanks, and praise for the dying and undying love of Christ. In your great goodness, you have brought us into communion with him and with all who love him, and made us heirs of your everlasting kingdom. By your grace, may we continue in this holy fellowship and live to the glory of your name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We sing hymn 519, Love Divine, All Loves Excel. May the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you now.